Is vitamin C actually good for the eyes? First, this is an amazing question. I personally love the whole idea of supplementation and having proper nutrition to help heal the body, including the eyes. Hey, you guys have been asking a lot of questions about the eyes, and I've been listening, so let's get into it. All right, so first question is how to remove eyes sclera, yellow, and brown spots. So what I think you're asking here, Siddhartha, is about colored brown spots on the surface of the eye, on the white part of the eye, probably specifically. That area is called the conjunctiva, and underneath it is the sclera. That's, again, that white part. Now, when you have a brown spot or color on the eye, most of the time, that is just normal. We, in fact, call that racial melanosis. If you're somebody with a darker complexion, then it could be just something that you're born with, similar to a freckle. However, if it ever grows or changes, that is a sign of concern. It could potentially grow into things like melanoma. That's potential cancer of the eye. So it's important that you do seek medical attention if you feel like something is new or growing, getting any bigger, starting to have a different shape, getting red. That's definitely a sign to get it checked out. Just another kind of good food for thought is to wear sunglasses and a wide-brimmed hat whenever you're outside, because UV light from the sun, even on a cloudy day, can still get to those tissues and really kind of propagate towards something like a melanoma. Dude, your doctor, question mark, how old are you? You look like you're 17 years old. So funny enough, I get this a lot of time. I'm 31 at the timing of this video. My birthday's coming up in October, so I'll be 32. But yeah, when I was at the hospital, I got that even more. And that was like 5 years ago. And funny enough, my nickname was Doogie Howser when I was there. Is vitamin C actually good for the eyes? First, this is an amazing question. I personally love the whole idea of supplementation and having proper nutrition to help heal the body, including the eyes. With vitamin C, it's in very high concentration inside the eye, both in the aqueous humor, which is the clear flowing blood on the inside of the eye that gives nutrients to the different structures of the inside, as well as in the vitreous humor. That's the gel inside the eye that eventually floaters develop in there. And the high concentrations of vitamin C is believed to act as an antioxidant to slow down damaging or aging changes inside the eye, because the eye has such a high metabolism because of all the light energy going into it all of the time. With that being said, they have done studies on different eye supplements, and vitamin C is one of the major ingredients for the standard eye vitamins that we use for conditions like age-related macular degeneration, a blinding eye disease. And I do have a video, actually a live stream I did, that goes really in depth into macular degeneration and even talks about more of the supplementation and what's in the supplements. If you do want to check out that video, I will hook that up here to the side as well as in the YouTube description below. Because if you or a family member has something like age-related macular degeneration, or maybe that runs in your family, then you probably want to check out that video. The only thing is about vitamin C supplementation is beyond what has been proven to help if somebody has a diagnosis of macular degeneration, is that supplementation, specifically for taking vitamin C as a supplement, hasn't necessarily been like really proven in standard testing to really improve anything within the eye or even prevent that much disease. But it is believed that some sort of diet or having good nutrition of having good amounts of vitamin C in the eye may at least contribute some degree of reducing oxidative stress, development of cataracts, potentially retinal diseases. All right, now what does PD57 mean? I don't understand my glasses prescription. So PD on your glasses prescription stands for pupillary distance. Now, this used to be a pretty standard measurement that we include during the examination. Nowadays, it's not really as important. It's more part of the glasses really fitting process. If you go into a glasses optical shop, they will measure your pupillary distance. This is very easily done on your own if you have a millimeter ruler. However, if you do go into an optical, they have cool pupillometers, which measure the pupillary distance to a really precise degree. And it's basically a measurement from the center of one pupil to the center of the other pupil. However, keep in mind, even though your pupillary distance may be something like 60 centimeters, like mine is, usually one side is not perfectly symmetrical versus the other side. So mine's actually 30.5 on the between my nose and my right eye, and 29.5 from my nose to my left eye. If you are also planning to use the pupillary distance to buy glasses online, do keep in mind that there's more than just a pupillary distance between the eyes for a fitting of glasses. There's also the optical center height from the bottom of the lens, not the bottom of the frame, but the bottom of the lens to the center of the eye to having the right fit for those lenses. And that's exactly why so many online retailers, people who get those glasses, usually it's not as accurate as if you get something through an in-store optical. Okay, so I don't know why, but I put a soda can tab in my mouth and I see bright flashes like a camera flash. What? I don't even know what that means. I suppose it's like getting foil in your mouth and it's hitting fillings? I don't know. Hi, Optometrist Online says, as a practitioner, what do you like better to use, Lipiflow or iLux? Thanks, Sarah. Well, thank you, Sarah. I think it's awesome that other eye care professionals either watch the channel or leave comments like this. So this is super cool. I have used both Lipiflow and iLux. I think both are fantastic, and if you really go into this research and the studies, they're basically comparable as the same results. The Lipiflow is nice in the clinic because you can just set it up and let it run. The downside is I feel like I don't really know as a practitioner if all of the oil glands that we measured with mybography really had an effect, where with iLux, either if I'm doing it myself, I can hold it and see that it's working. So I like the benefit of iLux for that reason. And with the newer generation of the iLux device, I believe they do have a camera or even a video function on there. So you can even record or take pictures of the results, which I think is kind of just kind of a useful tool for education and to kind of be able to show the patient that, hey, these are the results that you're getting. All right, is vitamin A or lutein help with floaters and cataracts? Again, I love this sort of supplementation stuff. Vitamin A, huge part of eye health, and that's why everyone says, hey, eat your carrots. And there's a whole other funny story behind vitamin A and the belief and how that works for the eye. But in general, vitamin A does play a role with the retina in the back of the eye in helping regenerate photoreceptors inside the eye. And people who don't have enough vitamin A or they don't absorb it correctly, they do have problems with nyctalopia and having trouble seeing at nighttime, as well as can develop a really severe form of dry eye with a little growth in the eye called a Bytot spot. And then lutein for the back of the eye, that is a very powerful antioxidant and is often used in the most recent updated eye supplements for, again, macular degeneration, because it can really help the retina, especially in the center of the retina, which is most highly metabolic tissue of the retina. So vitamin A and lutein, as far as floaters and cataracts, I don't think it's gonna hurt. It certainly can't make your cataracts or your floaters worse. Could it really help for those? I haven't seen any studies that really indicate or prove that it really helps for floaters or cataracts, but again, it's not gonna hurt. One other thing though, is if you have been a smoker in the past, you do not wanna take supplementations of vitamin A. That has been proven time and time again in the studies that if you were a smoker and you're taking vitamin A supplements, that increases your risk of lung cancer. So yeah, watch that. All right, do contact lenses for colorblind people? Mendoza, yes, there are contact lenses for people with color blindness, but technically it's called color vision deficiency, but yeah, I know our culture says colorblind. But yes, these contact lenses are called X-chrome or X-chrome lenses. They are red contact lenses that usually are worn on one eye. And with that contrast created between the red light, kind of hue of everything versus what you have, it's easier to discern the difference between different colors, and that gives people more of a better perception of what colors are really out there, making it easier again to kind of navigate your surroundings. But unfortunately, it doesn't just add pop color to everything and seeing normal like a normal color vision person would. Okay, Warped Trekker asks, can Ortho-K work on older adults too? Yes. Ortho-K is awesome. I feel bad because I haven't gotten to this video yet. I had something planned and then COVID happened, so I had to change directions a little bit. Ortho-K lenses still can flatten the cornea and give you good vision. It's a great alternative for people who don't want to go through LASIK and still want to have clear vision throughout the day without having to wear glasses or contacts during the day. Hey, great video. Do you recommend anything for pterygium? Thank you. This is a great question. In fact, I should do a video on pterygiums and pinguiculas because they're pretty common. In fact, I have a lot of, it's one of the more common things I've ever seen when I go on mission trips. A Pinguecula, pterygium, these growths on the eye, these are often caused by UV sunlight exposure as well as dryness, certainly salt water. Some pterygiums, in fact, a lot of people call them surfer's eye, and that's from all the salt water and irritants getting to the surface of the eye and sunlight bouncing off the water and hitting them twice. So the best things for you to do if you have these conditions is wear sunglasses, especially face form sunglasses, ones that wrap all the way around your face because you block out the sunlight hitting you from the side and bouncing into the eye. That'll protect your eye from the sunlight exposure, preventing it getting worse. Same thing if your eyes are really dry, if you're in some sort of a climate or a dusty environment, make sure to use frequent eye drops just to kind of lubricate the eyes and flush out any debris that's getting in there. If it is something that's getting aggravating, getting worse, speak to your doctor. They can either get you steroid eye drops or if need be, they can have surgical correction to remove them. Pewter glass or blue cut glass? Me personally, I've trying a lot of different glasses. That's a big part of this show is that I personally want to find the best products and I want to be able to share them with you guys. Personally, if you're spending a lot of time on the computer, and I've done videos about this, I think that if you have a dedicated prescription pair of glasses for the computer or computer glasses, I think that's going to relieve eye strain the most, as well as any sort of headaches and issues like that. Blue light protection, as blue light filters in your glasses can give additional help for some people and even maybe protect your eyes from sleep cycle changes. But otherwise, I do have a special pair of my prescription computer glasses here that correct a little bit more of my astigmatism and are set for my set typical reading distance when I'm on a computer screen. But yes, these also do have blue light protection built into them. Can 12-year-olds wear cosplay contacts? Thank you, Anime for Life, because this is an excellent question. Really, anybody can get contact lenses at any age, because even infants can wear contact lenses. Yes, some children are born without a lens inside the eye. We call that a phakia, or they need to go through some surgery at a young age. So we need to prescribe special contacts and teach the parents how to put contact lenses on an infant so that the infant can see. But yes, 12-year-olds can certainly wear contact lenses. Yes, they can wear cosplay contacts. The big thing with children is you want them to have, if you're a parent, as an example, or even if you're maybe 12 and you want to wear contacts, a big thing is maturity. We want to make sure that you're taking contact lenses and using them responsibly and not sleeping in them, you have to be cleaning them correctly because there is a higher risk of infection with contact lenses. You can hurt your eyes permanently with contact lenses. So a good rule of thumb that myself and many other eye doctors use is if you are old enough and the kid is responsible enough to keep their bedroom clean, then they're likely going to still keep their contact lenses clean and do better with contacts. Vecchi asks, I have amblyopia and eye floaters too. What do I do? I am 13. When it comes to things like this and you have any sort of eye health medical condition going on, definitely reach out to your local eye care provider. Being 13 years old and having amblyopia, that's something I have videos on amblyopia and kind of the treatments that are out there for it. But definitely speaking to your eye doctor if it's something that they can treat, whether it's something you need surgery for, is it something that you just need glasses? Maybe you need to do some eye patching or use eye drops or vision therapy or a combination of all of those. If you have eye floaters, that's a little bit tough because yes, you can have floaters at any age. Even youngest age I've ever read in my textbooks was an autopsy report of a child around the age of 4 who had floaters inside their eye. In general, floaters you get more often as you get older. As you get age 55 and above, they're pretty frequent to have. If you're more nearsighted like I am, then you can get floaters way earlier. That's pretty typical. I've had floaters since my early 20s. But yes, still same thing. If you're having any sort of big issues with your eyes, definitely reach out to your local eye care professional because they're gonna be able to look at your eye and make sure that there's nothing else going on, that you have the right diagnosis, and they'll be able to apply the best treatment for you in your case. All right, guys, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. And please, if you want to see more Q&A videos like this, drop questions and comments in the section below. I'd love to hear from you guys. I try to be active in the comments as much as I can, and I hope to do more videos just like this. So smash that like button for me, subscribe, and share this video with friends and family. And otherwise, keep an eye on it, and we'll talk to you soon.